Good morning, everyone. I'm Damini. I'm part of the group of three people Nikita just mentioned. I, Khushbu, and Akshara together designed and implemented the social action project on conscious raising the role and identity of women in the Indian household. I'll be sharing the presentation. We'll just be taking like 20 minutes of your time to run you through our experience, how we went about organizing it, then we went about implementing it, and the immense support that we got from everybody who was engaged at different levels. I hope my screen's visible. When the idea over the course of the, I think, 8 or 7 months of fellowship, we were basically actually stuck at home attending the sessions, apart from 2 days when we actually came to the Priya office. But all the sessions that were introduced to us related to gender, identity of the self, understanding the society, understanding how participatory research exactly works. We actually brainstormed through it. We understood how issues have to be looked at from a perspective, maybe taking a bird's eye view beyond what we normally understand. And then by the time we were required to select our session, our social action project, all of us were on very different pages, to be honest. I had a different idea, Akshara had an altogether different. But during our in-office session that we had at the Priya office in February, somewhere around February, Khushbu introduced us to the idea of a consciousness-raising session that used to be held during the 1960s feminist movement in the United States. And she gave the idea about introducing it to women of our mother's age. I think Khushbu, when she was explaining it, we were very intrigued about the fact that you're talking about introducing women to everyday issues, that to women of our mother's age, who are a lot of times we see that they are far away from all these issues. But I think as we that is something which both clicked to both Akshara and me, and we got in touch with her and we discussed the idea further. But I'd say that we faced a couple of issues while going over it, because we did realize that due to the constraints related to the pandemic and limiting ourselves to the online mode, or even when we had discussions with Nikita and Rajesh sir a couple of times when we visited the office, we realized that maybe we need to reconsider our group and cohort on the basis of certain factors, such as which target group would be best benefited from this, what are the technicalities of actually implementing it, because all of these things were coming into play when we were looking at the group that we were considering. So we knew very well that we wanted to go ahead with consciousness raising as a tool of engaging people and understanding certain issues. But when we came down from engaging mothers of our age to women of our own age, the reason behind that was also the fact that we guys are, all of us in this age, are in an impressionable years. That's something that's commonly called. So whatever we learn over the course of our 20, 25 years till now, and whatever we realizations we have right now, are going to impact how we're going to take up things going ahead. So we decided best that we take it up and also take up this specific stakeholder group, and also that it would help us. And so honestly, we just kept into mind that it was easier for women of our age to join online as well. Pretty mummia वगैरह थोड़ा सा apprehensive होती हैं. So we kept all these things in mind and finally boiled down to sticking with women of the age group of 18 to 26 years and choosing consciousness raising. I'd say why we picked up the idea of the Indian household is that we see, and we did learn from our sessions that we had at Priya, is that a lot of identity related issues or a lot of socialization related factors that we learn over the course of our growth, like over the course of years, do impact how we see ourselves and others around us. So understanding certain points, certain factors, by keeping aside all these previous experiences, we might be able to, look at ourselves, be more kind to ourselves, be more kind to others as well. And for women, the very fact that we are actually limited in certain ways, given the society's idea of how a female should be, made it all the more important to adopt this. Why consciousness raising? Because Khushbu Akshara and I both realized when we were actually studying about consciousness raising is that it best, an issue is best understood when we're actually realizing it on our own, when we're discussing it amongst ourselves, amongst people who faced similar issues in their life. So it feels like it's there's this phrase, personal is political, which is used very frequently in women's movements in the was used in the 1960s and is relevant even today. And it is the crux of something which is a tool of consciousness raising. And it tells us that a lot of experiences that we consider personal to us are actually like largely political, existent in the larger section of the society of similar people, of similar experiences and age groups. And, you know, when we actually look at that issue from this point of view, we realize that this is not our own problem. This is, you know, coming from somewhere outside, and that we can deal it better by discussing it with other people. So hence we decided on consciousness raising as a tool to, understand the role of a female in the Indian household. What's their idea? What's their identity? What's their role? What have they understood till now? And what we actually need to understand going ahead, keeping ourselves apart from the social idea or the society's idea of a female in the Indian household. In terms of steps, we first act, like I explained, we went through understanding consciousness raising, understanding women's issues. We went through a couple of issues of women's life over the course of their lifespan, growing up, teenage years, then join education related issues, joining the workforce, getting married, then being a mother. So we picked up the entire life course and designed seven sessions around that to pick up, to make them understand how certain aspects that are considered very personal are actually something which other women do experience. And our target was that we'd act as mere facilitators and just push through certain icons, maybe pop culture related icons, which would engage the participants in a conversation and leave the floor to them to discuss and to try to find out amongst themselves. And we ourselves did share our own experiences to act as participants as well. We took feedback and we had discussions with the Priya team to just boil down to the crux of our structure, because like I mentioned, we did face certain difficulties in just going about the project, and I think it offered us great clarity because we do believe that their experience, they know better, they were able to offer us advice which was beyond what we could have, imagined, given we were just still in the structure phase of the project. Like I mentioned, we targeted younger women, decided to shift from older women. At one point of time, we were also considering engaging three generations. So we were like, hum grandmother se baat karenge, hum mother se baat karenge, and hum daughter se baat karenge. And it was slightly funny and slightly like a hilarious thing when Rajesh sir mentioned to us, ki aap log like infighting karwana chahte ho within a family by engaging three different levels, it would kind of create a controversial situation and might be difficult to handle. So then we came back to our original idea. We also considered engaging with women of the poorer and less privileged section, going to the ground and having a discussion with them. But then, unfortunately, due to the pandemic, the lockdown situation got aggravated, the second wave. And so we decided, let's stick to our own age group, girls of our age group, and within that income structure as well. Like I mentioned, we had to shift. We were exploring options to go to the ground. Had a word with Nikita, considered a couple of other places too for, conducting offline sessions, because consciousness raising actually happens best when you're face to face, when you're talking to people. We need to build a rapport with them. They need to build a rapport amongst themselves. But then we decided to shift online. And I think Khushbu and Akshara and the participants of our project would agree that it had certain limitations, but it was still good. We had the flexibility of time, at least. We would have our sessions at 9 o'clock at night every week. So it would go till 10:30. And I think that wouldn't have been possible had we done it in offline mode. We worked on the structure of it. We did realize that, earlier we were thinking we'd have to put in a lot of content in our project, but then we realized, that we just have to act as a trigger point, and as in not trigger negatively, but trigger positively, and just, let them know about something, introduce them to some issue and leave the floor to them. So in terms of the content of the sessions also, we brought it down significantly. Finally, we went ahead with the step of inviting participants. So first of all, we went ahead with the Google form to just discuss with them and, you know, ask them about what kind of issues they think relevant. And then in the second step, we had calls with all the applicants. We had discussion with them about the timings best suited to them, what issues they think are important and can be raised. And we boiled down to 8 participants who were, we did not actually select anybody, but we were just making sure that they're available on a regular basis. So it was not choosing between them, it was simply having a call with them, making sure that they're willing to, willing and able to join. Okay, so this is like one of the weird phases of the three of us discussing the project amongst ourselves. And I'd like to say that I think Khushbu and Akshara would agree with me. Most of the times you felt that hamari apni jo discussions hoti thi amongst ourselves would be like, you know, hum log khud hi consciousness raising mode mein pahunch jate the while considering these issues, and we'd like go into 2 or 3 hour long sessions amongst us, the three of us, ki ye hai, wo hai, and we'd get sometimes very charged up to ki nahi dekho aise bhi hota hai, waise bhi hota hai. And that is also when we, you know, realize the strength of our idea, the strength of consciousness raising as a tool, and how when we apply it to the specific issue that we're looking at, it would be most effective. Because I think in one way it was applied on ourselves too before we actually went ahead with engaging the participants. Yeah, inviting the participants, we designed a Google form, like I mentioned, spread it across through our channels, through Priya's channels, to invite applicants. We got somewhere around 65 or so plus applications, and then came down to finalizing 8 participants who agreed that they could come on a regular basis. The sessions, Akshara will be taking over from here to elaborate more on the actual implementation of the project. Akshara, over to you.
Good morning, everyone. And I'm Akshara, and I'll be further taking this along. So basically, like when we started with the sessions, like Damini already mentioned, we had a lot of team discussions and all. So these discussions would be lasting for like an hour and a half. And these were the most enjoyable phase, I would admit it here. So while we were thinking about the sessions, basically, we thought, how do we go ahead and how do we take it? So we realized the sessions need to be interesting. We realized the sessions need to be there to understand what is happening exactly in the life of a woman in an Indian household. What is the journey? What are the various phases, I would say, or what we would say the milestone as the society sees it. So all these sessions were based keeping that in mind. And like Damini said about the Google Forms regarding inviting applications, a lot of Google Forms were circulated, asking them what topics they would want, what they see it, why they are interested, and a lot of other details. With this, we got an idea what exactly we can go, like how we can go about, and the whole idea. So Damini, next slide, please. Yeah, so we decided on these 6 sessions finally. The first, so like we can see, the first session, gender and socialization, the second session, family, the third, education and career with marriage, and then menses and motherhood, and then the last, toxic masculinity and the way forward. So we realize these are the different stages in a, or the phases in a woman's life, and we need to focus on each of them. So our whole, at the back of the mind, we wanted to try the participatory approach, and we wanted to be there, like, you know, bring participants on the same level as us, and they also play a major role. And this was something we realized, this was happening at Priya. This was happening in our own discussion when we used to have team discussions. 3 of us would sit along, discuss a lot, make points. And this was something we wanted in the sessions as well. So the last session, we had a basic idea that these are the phases we want to focus. But by taking their idea and how they want to go along, we realized we needed the last session, the toxic masculinity and the way forward. Because we all know all this is happening, but what do we do from here? So with each session, we had a different focus. We started from the very stage of childhood, the gender, the socialization, the identity formation, how the family plays a role in it, the other major stage, the education and career with a girl getting married. And then definitely we realized we need to focus on a woman's body, the woman's body, which is seen as impure because of menses and the menstrual taboos which are existing, and is very pure and glorified whenever she's seen as a mother. This was something which was personally there in my mind too. And when I discussed it with Damini and Khushbu, I realized this was a concern there. And a lot of participants did say about taking a session on menstrual taboos. So that way, that was included here. And then the last session, as I said, toxic masculinity and the way forward. So these sessions, we had a basic idea. And then what we did was, we decided how do we want to go. So these sessions were taken over in a span of like around 3 months, I think March, April, May and June, 4 months. And every week there would be one session. So what we did was, what helped was that by asking participants each time, we got to know what were their what would be their preferences in everything, from understanding the what time the session to be taken to how the session is to be taken and how they would want it that way. Next slide, please, Dominique. Am I audible? Thank you. So what we finally came upon was that a session should not be too long and too short. So we decided 1.5 hour session would do. And since they were online, the Google Meet was the most convenient platform. This again was asked by the participants as well. It was our personal preference too. So in the whole thing, a lot of prior preparation used to take place for the implementation of the project. So what we used to do was we used to divide our roles. So in every session that would take place, there would be one leading facilitator and then there would be two co-facilitators. So the leading facilitator would be designing the content and everything, how it can be done. And we had our own ideas. And then a night before the session had to be taken, a day before, we would all meet. Mostly our meetings also used to take place at night. And I realized those timings, a session used to be from 9 to 10, 10:30 or 8:30 to 10. Our meetings used to be 9 to 10:30, 11, sometimes extending till 11:30 as well, one or two meetings. That was the least interrupted times we as girls would get in our house, both the participants as well as three of us. So that time we would sit, we would discuss, we would give each other opinions. And when we used to discuss, a lot of important content and information used to flow out and we used to realize, oh, we missed this, oh, we need to do this. So that was the one of the most enjoyable phase, I would say. So the leading facilitator would design the content, would be in charge of taking the session the next and going ahead with it. But the co-facilitators would be there, would know everything to help out, definitely. Because net connection was something which we all faced. Internet did really hamper our sessions a little. But the co-facilitator would also act as a participant in case the participants are hesitant in the sessions, they are not able to share their viewpoint and express them. So definitely the co-facilitator would be there to act like a participant and speak and create that space where every other person can speak. And further, since participatory approach was at the back of our mind and we wanted experiential sharing to happen, we wanted the experiences to freely flow out. Like we could share ours in the sitting in the office of Priya or among three of us ourselves. We did the same here. So that did happen. The experiential sharing happened. We used a lot of pop culture references. We used to show videos in the sessions so that those they can act as a catalyst, as a positive trigger point. I would again mention the word trigger. And the participants were free enough to share and they could do. So these were the pop culture references, some of them, which we definitely used. And we did discuss about a lot of novels and movies because we realized that was really, really giving good debates in the session. Debates did happen in the session. Keeping participants involved in each step was important. So we designed feedback forms. We took their feedbacks. After every session, we used to discuss among ourselves what went wrong, how could we improve it. We used to ask them about their feedback as well. So that was something which we realized did help us because, Damini, you can move. I was coming to challenges. So that was something I realized did help us. Challenges were not little. We did face challenges, and more about challenges, I would say they were our assumptions which helped us in designing and implementing the project better. So we had this in mind about limited participants. What if people don't join? What if they are not interested? Will they be ever sharing their experiences? Will we be able to provide the secure space and how to make sessions interesting? So what we for all these things, the first thing we did was to involve them at every step, to use the pop culture references. We realized that really, really worked. The discussions were there and sometimes the time used to exceed. In one or two sessions, the sessions went for 2 hours because nobody was ready to, you know, like just to stop. The discussion was just going on. We were involved. They were involved. Everybody was sharing. And I think that was one of the best moments when nobody cared about time and just went on speaking. And something I'm really, really proud of, and I think Khushbind Amni will agree with me, was that we were able to provide that secure space in the session where everybody could speak freely. And this space was something we got at Priya, and this space was something we were able to create in our session. That was something that I really liked. COVID-19, and like I said, limited participants also became a boon. I realized it. We realized it later because that sharing happened due to limited participants. Had there been more people, perhaps people would not have shared. COVID-19 did happen. We suffered from COVID. A few of our participants had COVID. And we did fear that after, like, you know, a month's gap in between, which was there, people will not join again for sessions. But when we restarted, they did join, and we were able to overcome that. So now Khushbu will be continuing with the feedback. Thank you.
Damini, you can change the slide now. Yeah, hello. Hi. So I will be talking about the feedback and some of the learning experiences which we had over the course of implementing the social action project. So we collected feedback through Google Forms, and one was by asking the participants to share their overall experience at the last, at the end of the last session. So one of the participants had mentioned how consciousness raising had been something she had only read about, and that too in the Western context. So to be a part of a CR initiative where you get to engage with the Indian realities became a very novel experience for her. And the reason why this feedback stuck with us is because that was one of our primary motivations as well, to practically experiment with an idea even we had just academically engaged with so far. Moving on to the idea of creating a safe space, something which Akshara has already talked about. This was a response which got reflected in the feedback forms as well. The participants did feel that a secure platform was provided to them where they could express their opinions without feeling that they might be judged or there might be anything apathetic. I feel like we also believe that the diversity of opinions which we came across reflected that fact. And we also believe that the credit for creating the secure space in large part goes to the participants as well, because regardless of how diverse the opinions were, they would always be mature enough to respectfully engage with each other and understand each other's point of view. Also, like, since we were engaging with women who were pursuing their higher education, it was obvious that they would have some basic idea about these issues. But still, you know, for these participants, the fact that they got to come together to talk about their experiences, to resonate with other people's life experiences and experience that sense of solidarity, it became pretty cathartic for them, right? We had some constructive criticism as well. Something which Damini mentioned was, no, I think Akshara. So one of them mentioned how we tried to limit the session to 90 minutes, but still there were times when we exceeded that time limit. There were times when people felt that it was getting a little lengthy. Another participant suggested that we could have, you know, we should be conducting something like consciousness raising among the more underprivileged sections of the society. And that was something we agreed with 100%, but it's just that COVID-related exigencies had made us rule that option out. Another very important feedback we received was how our sessions had mainly focused on awareness building. While that is very important, the participant also felt that we could have talked about more about the tools to navigate and tackle such challenges. To be fair, we did substantially talk about it in the last session, but in hindsight, maybe a better approach could have been to talk about the tools in every session. So, you know, you get to figure out how you deal with different phases of your life. Moving on to the next slide, Damini. So these are just snippets from the feedback form. This would be regarding the content of the sessions and how participants felt about that. Next slide, please. Yeah, this was regarding the content of the session. So majority of them felt that it was something which was comprehensive, relevant and relatable, easy to understand. Yeah, next slide. So after we got done with our sessions, we did send this small token of appreciation in the form of a book on feminism and a journal to the regular participants. These are just pictures from that. Moving on. So coming to the learnings now, to state the most obvious learning first, we developed a deeper understanding of how gender works in the familial context. And when you are engaging with a topic like this over the course of a few months, it starts to get reflected in your mindset and your actions as well. So it could be little things like the nature of conversations which you're having with your mother, or how you intervene when it comes to, say, housework sharing arrangements. So the little nuances which you're noticing. Another thing would be, through this little project of ours, we realized just how impactful deliberations are in any setting, something which Damini and Akshara have gone on to talk about. We believe that through those discussions which we would have amongst ourselves, there would be so many realizations which were coming up. And we believe that we tried to incorporate a more democratic mindset in those discussions too, because like it's not like we wouldn't have disagreements, but our approach would always be to evolve a consensus of sorts to make sure that everyone was on the same page and to ensure that everyone got a chance to make their point heard. Another thing was even the sessions. So they would always be very refreshing because all the participants, they would have such unique, different, interesting takes on different situations. So we would also, we felt that it was a learning experience for us as well. And this sentiment, it got reflected in the feedback forms as well, because as one participant, she rightly noted, was that through these sessions, she realized how your valid opinion can always come across an equally valid counter opinion. And it is when you take both these opinions together, not only you develop a deeper and a broader understanding, you become more tolerant as well. So that was an important learning for us and the participants. Coming together, to talk about how it was working as a team.
Guys, I want you to please wrap up. I'm enjoying listening to you, but you also have other presentations.
I'm just wrapping up. Yeah, so I think it was pretty great to work in Damini and Akshara because like all of us, we brought different things to the table. Damini is someone who's a great organizer. Akshara always has great ideas. And also, we believe that all of us, we help to ground our ideas and make them more practical. Another thing, just the last thing, would be that last year, given COVID and other things which were happening, as an individual, maybe it would have been justified for us to give up. But because the three of us were working together, in a way, we also pushed each other to bring this project to a fruition. Secondly, I mean, we gained a lot of insights as a facilitator as well, making sure of the little things like keeping the sessions light, not making it very scholarly, to take a middle ground to stop the session from digressing a lot. And that is about it. The next slide would talk about our output. Besides the official report which we have sent to Priya, we are also planning, we decided to convert our sessions into a 7-article series. We have approached a few web organizations related to that and we're awaiting their responses. That is it. Thank you so much. This was our time in Priya when we got to meet everyone else. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you very, very much for this lovely presentation.
A last note of thanks to everybody at Priya for their immense support and for giving the three of us this opportunity as a fellowship and then even as a social action project. To our participants, because I think this wouldn't have been possible if they hadn't taken the pain every single weekly night to come and join, and all the co-fellows, because we would read about their projects. We would, when we met them, they gave us very good feedback and it improved our